Good morning and welcome to Calendar Bay Church Online. I'm Pastor John Intoff, and thank you so much for joining us for our online service today. I hope that you had a great few weeks. I know that I did. I had some holidays and time away and a great time of rest and relaxation. Also was able to visit with some family, my parents, my mother-in-law, and also got to see our granddaughter. So it was just a great time to be able to do some visiting. Thank you so much for being a part of our services here at Calendar Bay Church. And there's a few ways that you can do that. One, you can do what you're doing presently, which is watching the service online. You can do that two different ways. One, you can watch the YouTube premiere, which takes place Sunday morning, 10:30 a.m. And you can watch the services with others and interact at the same time. After that point, it's available at any time, and so you can watch it at your own convenience. And so I would encourage you, you can get caught up on some messages that you missed, maybe even watch a series that you hadn't watched before. And so both of those options are available online. We also have our in-person worship service, which takes place here at Calendar Bay Church on Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m. And so you can join together with others here at the church and just enjoy a time of fellowship and enjoying being in God's presence together. Well, just to keep you updated about what's going on here at Calendar Bay Church, the best way to do that is to go online to our website, calendarbaychurch.ca, and go to the bulletins, /bulletins, and you'll find the most recent bulletin, which gives you updates of all the different things that are going on here at Calendar Bay Church. And so it's just a great resource. If you would like to print it off, there's a PDF that you can print right there. And so that is available online at calendarbaychurch.ca. You can also give safely and securely by going online to our webpage, calendarbaychurch.ca/give, and the instructions are there of how you can e-transfer to help support the ministry here at Calendar Bay Church. You can also mail your gift in, and all you have to do for that is send it to our mailing address, which is Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. Again, that's Calendar Bay Church, Box 218, Calendar, Ontario, P0H1H0. We're looking forward to a great week here at Calendar Bay Church. It's our high power soccer week, and so maybe you can pray this week for our camp. That'll be a great time, that there'll be ministry to the kids, that people will be safe. And so please be in prayer for our high power soccer this week. We're going to take some time. Last week would have been normally a communion week, but because I was away, we want to celebrate communions today. And just to prepare our thoughts, we want to sing together this great song, At the Cross Where Love Ran Red. It's just a great reminder of what God did for us, and let's sing it together and focus our thoughts.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. And there's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. Mm-hmm.
This morning we want to take time to be able to remember together. The Word of God encourages us to take time and to remember Christ's sacrifice on the cross. It's a great way to give thanks for our own salvation, for the fact that Jesus came to this earth to die for our sins so that we could have life. And so as we do that, we just want to take a moment just to be able to reflect on the life that Christ gives us. You know, each and every day that we live is a special gift from God. And so what I want us to do is to just take a few moments. You know, Matt Redman wrote the great song, 10,000 Reasons. There are so many reasons that we can give thanks to God. And so what I want you to do is just to take a moment right now and just to be able to reflect and give thanks. The Bible tells us to give thanks in all circumstances. And so it doesn't matter whether your circumstances are good right now or whether they're bad, whether you're in a time of joy or a time of sadness. The Word of God tells us to reflect and to give thanks. It's a good exercise for each one of us. And as we partake in the greatest gift that's been ever given in the gift of Jesus Christ, it's good to be able to reflect on that. And so just let's take a moment right now and to be able to give thanks to God. God, we have so much to be grateful for. The beauty of nature, the joy of family, the companionship of friends, your provision on a daily basis. God, for health, for strength, for daily food, all these blessings that you freely give. And God, for some of us that maybe it's just a little bit harder to find that thing to give thanks for, we thank you that even in the midst of difficulty and trial, we can consider those things of pure joy because of the life that you give to us. And so, God, we offer these thanksgivings as a sacrifice of praise to you. It says that you inhabit the praise of your people, and so we just lift these praises and thanks up to you, knowing that in that process, we experience your presence. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. And every time you eat of it, do it in remembrance of me." Let's eat together. Jesus also, on the night that he was betrayed, he took the cup and he said, "The cup represents the new covenant that is in my blood. And every time you drink of it, do it in remembrance of me until I return." The communion time is a time where we reflect and we remember also that Christ is going to return. That we are living in the piece of history where we can look forward with hope and anticipation to his coming. But in these days, God also wants us to bring our cares and our concerns to him. It's such an awesome privilege to be able to know that the God of the universe loves us so much that he longs for us to bring our prayers and our petitions. And in that exchange of giving them, he gives us his peace that passes all understanding. And so let's just take a moment right now, and wherever you are, let's just give those things to God, knowing that in that moment, he's going to transfer us his peace. And so let's give those things to him. God, each one of us have our cares and our concerns, our health issues, our anxieties, these different things that we are struggling and wrestling with. And God, right now, we take those things and give them to you, knowing that you are much better and capable of handling these things than we are. And God, in that exchange, your word promises us your peace. And so, God, in the name of Jesus, we claim your peace. The peace that passes all understanding. A peace that can be a revelation of our relationship with you. Because you came to bring us peace with God. And so, God, we thank you that we can bring these cares and our concerns. And that you are able to handle them. And you are able to do great and mighty things. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's drink together. As we take time to prepare for hearing from God's word this morning, I'm going to encourage us to sing this great song, Holy Spirit. It's, again, a song of invitation, just inviting the Holy Spirit to work in the way that He can only work. And so let's sing this song together and worship Him.
The atmosphere, your glory, God, is what all. for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Over the summer months, we've been looking at the life of David and all the lessons that we can learn from his life. And so far as we've looked at the life of David, we've seen him in a number of different roles. The first, we saw him as the anointed of God, that God was looking for someone to lead his people. And David is the one that is anointed into that role. And we've also seen him as the man after God's own heart, as he was seeking it. You know, God didn't look on the outward appearance. He wanted to look on the inside, and he discovered an individual in David that was a man after his own heart. And God desires that we be those kind of people as well, that seek after him and to put him first in all circumstances. And we've also seen David in the role, and this is the one that he's probably most famous for, as the giant killer, the one and that conquers in God's power, the person that looks from the outside like he's not able to do it, but yet he is able to conquer because of God's strength in his life. We've also seen as David is that loyal friend, the one that really became a friend to Jonathan, and that relationship really grew. We've seen him as a hero, as he was given some impossible tasks, and yet he was able to rise up because of God's strength in him and to be the hero of the people. We've seen him being strong in the midst of adversity. And so although he was given adverse circumstances, he was still able to be strong in the midst of that. Well, today we kind of take a next step. I remember a number of years ago, I've actually thought of writing a book called Everything I Needed to Learn in Life, I Learned on Gilligan's Island. And this is one of the things that I learned on Gilligan's Island. I learned about spelunking. Now, I don't know if you remember this from an episode, but they were looking in caves, and so they needed to be spelunkers. And spelunking is actually that. It's looking in caves. And then today, in our message today, we want to look at David as David actually learn some lessons while he wasn't really spelunking, looking, searching around in caves, but they were still lessons that were learned in caves. And the reason that he's in caves or a cave is because he's really hit rock bottom in his life. You know, probably at some point or another in your life, you've had that moment where you just felt like everything that could be broken is broken, and you just absolutely and utterly hit rock bottom in your life. I remember I was watching a TV show, and there was a quote in the show which stood out to me, and it said, "It's best to never say you've hit rock bottom. Trust me, you can always go lower." And so sometimes when we think we've hit rock bottom, I've had this experience where I thought, you know what, I don't think that this can get any worse than this. And then you realize that you weren't at rock bottom, that other things went wrong, and you discovered that rock bottom was actually a little more elusive than you thought, and it was further than you thought you would have to go. But the valuable thing about rock bottom is that rock bottom will teach you lessons that the mountaintop never will. There are things that you learn in the bottom or at the bottom. There are things that you learn, as David does in the cave, that you won't grow or you won't be able to learn. You know, as David was spinning the slingshot and taking down Goliath, he learned a lot, and there were important things that he learned. But there are lessons that you learn when you're at rock bottom that you can't learn anywhere else. And we see the process as you go through 1 Samuel. You will see this process begin to take place. And what begins to happen is that, you know, David has had some things that he can lean on during this time. But during this dark time of moving towards the caves, all of those crutches, those things that were holding him up, began to be strategically removed. And so during this, he loses his position. He had moved up into the in the military, but an interaction with Saul completely removes that, and now he's on the run from Saul. So he's lost his position. He is no longer that. In the midst of this, if you know the story, and we've been talking about this, David gets married to one of Saul's daughters. And because of some different interactions, he loses his wife in the midst of this. So the person that was, she loved him, but over this period of time, there's a fracture that takes place in their relationship, and it never fully recovers. In the midst of this, he and Samuel get separated. Samuel has always been the one that has been his number one supporter, because he knew that God had placed his hand on David. And so Samuel was always that voice of reason, the voice of God in his life. And they become separated. Because of circumstances, he and his relationship with Jonathan becomes strained, and they actually have to separate. And so he loses his best friend. At another point, and there's a story in Scripture, and you can read through these chapters in 1 Samuel, he loses his self-respect. He actually pretends that he's insane, says that he talks foolishly, and he actually pretends like he's got spittle in his beard to make himself look like he's actually lost his marbles. And so he loses his self-respect. And so all of these different things lead to this point, which we find in 1 Samuel 22, verses 1 and 2. And this is what it says. David left Gath and escaped to the cave Adullam. And when his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him there too. All those who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him, and he became their leader. About 400 men were with him. And so here we have David ending up in this cave. And it's actually interesting because it becomes kind of this cave of failure, and he attracts all the people that have experienced failure in their life. And so these are people, it talks about his own family. His family comes to him, but they've all been displaced because, well, if your Saul is hunting down David, there seems to be some forgiveness from the earlier days where his brothers didn't want to have anything to do with them, were kind of mocking him. Now, they're all coming together, but they've all been displaced because of these circumstances. It says that all the distressed, those that were depressed and overwhelmed, they gathered with him. And there, it says that those that were under financial strain, they were all in debt, and they ended up there. And it says that they were also the discontented. They ended up there as well. God teaches some valuable lessons in this cave of failure that they all find themselves in. And actually, David writes about his experience while he's there in the book of Psalms. Two of the Psalms, one Psalm 142 and Psalm 57, it actually tells and refers directly to this experience and says that this was written while he was in the cave. Some commentators also think that Psalm 31 was in that experience as well because of the themes that it picks up on. And so we want to take a closer look at these Psalms and what David learns while he is in the cave. And so if you have your Bible, follow along in Psalm 142. We're going to read the whole psalm together. Psalm 142 says, I cry aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out before him my complaint. Before him I tell my trouble. When my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who watch over my way. In the path where I walk, people have hidden a snare for me. Look and see, there is no one at my right hand. No one is concerned for me. I have no refuge. No one cares for my life. I cry to you, Lord, and I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Listen to my cry, for I am in desperate need. Rescue me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me. Set me free from my prison, that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness to me. And so David learned some valuable lessons. The first thing is that he declared to God his discouragement. You know, he's not shy in hiding his emotions. Sometimes, you know, we think that we have to kind of say, pray in kind of proper terms and King James and only pray in a certain way. But David is honest before God and declares to him all the things that are going on. And so as we look at that, it says, I cry out aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out before him my complaint. Before him I tell my trouble. And there's some valuable things that we learn. David is hurt enough to admit his need. He is overwhelmed with pain because of what he's experienced. And he is hurt enough to admit the fact that he has a need. Most of us, we like to keep it hidden. We like to keep it under wraps. How you doing? I'm fine. All is good. We want to keep up the appearance. But David was hurt enough to know that he needed to admit his need to God. And the other thing is that he's honest enough to cry out for help. He realizes that he is completely overwhelmed. His experiences, everything that he has leaned on, is all been taken away. And he's at rock bottom. And he's honest enough to admit to himself and to God that he is absolutely in desperate need of help. And David is also humble enough to be able to learn from God. He's not just crying out and looking for an instant answer. He wants to learn from God. He humbles himself so that God is going to lift him up. And there's a really valuable lesson in that. Do we acknowledge enough the hurt that we've experienced and cry out to God for help? Are we honest enough to say, yeah, you know what? That really did hurt. And that was very difficult. And we're honest enough to admit that before God. And are we humble enough to come to him for the assistance we need? And so the first thing that David does while he's in the cave, and the lesson that we can learn, is that he declares his discouragement. And then he goes on and he discovers refuge. In the midst of this difficulty, he discovers refuge. It says, I cry to you, Lord, and I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. The other psalm that I mentioned in Psalm 57:1 says, have mercy on me, my God, have mercy on me, for in you I take refuge, in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. And then we have Psalm 31. And it says, in you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. And so David discovers refuge. And why is that important? Why do we need refuge? David really discovers this refuge in God. Why does he need that? Well, there's a number of reasons. Because life can be difficult, distressing, and depressing. It can be completely overwhelming. And actually, you know what? Stats show us that this generation is finding life to be completely and utterly overwhelming. Anxiety is through the roof. Depression is through the roof. Loneliness is through the roof. All these different things are causing us so much problem. But oftentimes we begin to look all sorts of other places in order to be able to find some fulfillment and to kind of try to bring us hope in the midst of that, or at least not, if not even hope, just trying to make ourselves feel better. But David discovers that the real place to look is to find refuge in God. And so if we are feeling that life is difficult, that life is hard, that it's distressing us, and that we are depressed and overwhelmed, we need to discover, like David did, that the real thing that we need to be looking for is refuge. We need to have refuge. Second reason we need to find refuges is because our failures, mistakes, and guilt overwhelm us. You know, sometimes we start reflecting on life and we start thinking about all the things that we've done wrong and the mistakes that we've made. And we discover that there's just this overwhelming sense of guilt. There's this overwhelming sense of not measuring up. That we have this overwhelming sense that our performance has not been good enough. And the Bible tells us that in that state, his word says that therefore in Christ there is no condemnation. And so we don't have to let those voices define us. We can find refuge in him. There is so much in life that can drag us down, and those voices can speak negatively in our lives. And we discover that really what we need is refuge. And the last reason we need to have refuges is because our adversaries can assault us. You know, in this world, the Bible promises us that there'll be some troubles that we face. It says that the devil himself goes around like a roaring lion, that there are adversaries that are on this journey that are going to try to take us down. And the only place that we can find what we need is in the refuge of God. It is only there that we can truly find strength for the day, is in the refuge of God. So the Bible tells us that David, first he said he just discovered the fact that he was overwhelmed and he cried out to God. And then he discovered the refuge of God. And then it goes on and then it tells us that David delights in the discovery that he makes. He delights in the discovery. This is what it says in Psalm 57, 9 to 11. It says, I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. David discovers a number of key things that are so important. First, he discovers in this position where he has been laid low, he discovers the greatness of the love of God. He says, how great is the love of God? He is overwhelmed by the fact of how much God loves him. Even in this dark, dark place, his love, God's love is revealed to him in such an amazing way that he sees the greatness of the love of God. And it's only in this position, as everything else is stripped away, it's taken away, all his crutches are removed, and all that remains at the end of it is the love of God. And the Word of God tells us in Romans chapter 8 that nothing, absolutely nothing, can ever separate us from the love of God. And then he discovers the overwhelming faithfulness of God. That even in the midst of his circumstances, he sees that God is faithful. All the time, God is faithful. God is working his plans out for good. God is accomplishing good for those that love him and are called according to his purposes. God is faithful and he is completing his things. And so as everything else, again, is stripped away, he discovers the love of God and he discovers that God is always faithful. And David also discovers something very interesting. he discovers there is the depth of his desire to praise God. That because of the love of God and because of the faithfulness of God, he needs to respond somehow. These two principles that when everything else is taken away remain, his response is to praise God. Now, one of my favorite songs right now is a song by Brandon Lake called I'll Praise You Anywhere. And the song is just, you know, talking about the difficulties and the hardships. And then he says, I'll give you praise in the highest. I'll praise you anywhere, which is exactly what David does. Even in the darkest moment, what erupts out of his life is absolute and utter praise for God. And we need to begin to take on that attitude. Many times we get to into these dark places, and what do? We end up getting depressed and overwhelmed. David doesn't do that. When all is stripped away, he discovers the two most important things, the love of God and the faithfulness of God. And because of that, he is overwhelmed with praise. And the response is, you know, you can see these things written in the book of Psalms. He erupts in praise because of what, and he says, I'll tell the nations about how great God is. And I'll praise him to the highest all the time. So here we have David in the cave. And he learns these incredible lessons that sustain him throughout his life. What cave lessons is God asking you to learn? You know, maybe on your journey, you've hit rock bottom, and it is just, you can't believe it, and that things have worked out the way that you had so many high expectations of how things were going to go, and they just haven't worked out, and you just are feeling completely overwhelmed. Where are you on the journey? Maybe God is saying to you, you know what? You just need to cry out to me. Humble yourself. Admit you're at the end of your rope. Cry out to him. Because only there you'll begin to discover the refuge that you really need. Maybe that's where you're at. You just need to discover the refuge of God. That in the midst of all those circumstances, he can be that place of sustaining that you've always desired and needed. But maybe God is trying to get you to discover the delights of him in the midst of this. When everything else has been stripped away, which is often what the cave is doing, it's stripping away all the things that you have relied on in your life. You know, one of the major things that I've seen in people's lives is that when your health fails, many people discover the depths of God. As that crutch has been removed, God becomes their refuge, and they discover the delights of God in the midst of that adversity, in the cave, in the difficulty. God wants you to discover the greatness of his love and the wonderfulness of his faithfulness. And he wants that to result in praise to him, no matter what the circumstances. So as you were in the cave, maybe God's trying to teach you some lessons, because these are lessons you can learn nowhere else. You may desire the mountaintop, but it's in the valley that God does his greatest work. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can learn from David's life. And as he walked through this difficulty, we see that you can walk through our difficulty and teach us the same lessons, so that we can discover at the end of it all the greatness of your love and the beauty of your faithfulness. God, help that to erupt in praise to you for who you are. That we would take David's attitude of, we're going to tell the nations about this great, incredible thing that God has done. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I love this song. It's a great reminder. It says that God is our refuge and our strength, and He has made us glad. And so let's sing this together and make it your song of worship to Him, a song of praise to Him, erupting out of the greatness and the love of God.
Shelter, strong tower, my very
Well, God bless you. I hope that you have an amazing week. We'll be back again next week with another great message from God's Word. Hey, if you're watching during the YouTube premiere, you can just join in on the discussion as we close the service, just to be able to encourage and bless one another. And I hope that you have a wonderful week. God bless you.
You are my